After coming off a 5-11 season in 2020, Matt Rhule enters his second year in the NFL as a head coach, and he found himself a new quarterback over the offseason. Carolina, of course, acquired Sam Darnold from the Jets, a former third overall pick back in 2018, and they're hoping that somehow they can make him into a franchise quarterback for Carolina. Now, Darnold should have 2 years to prove himself because he has the fourth year of his rookie contract. They picked up the fifth year option, so he should have at least 2 years unless this year goes absolutely terrible for him. He should have 2 years to prove he's the guy in Carolina. Now, back in January, the Panthers hired a new GM named Scott Fitterer, who spent 20 years with the Seattle Seahawks organization. Of course, Seattle had some really good teams back in the day, so that guy comes over with some good experience. You have a head coach in year two, a new GM. I think a new owner took over a few years back, so a lot of newness here with the Carolina Panthers, and that's very exciting, of course. And basically, the bottom line for Carolina is this. They have a lot of young and exciting players like Brian Burns and Jeremy Chinn, now J.C. Horn, Derek Brown. It just depends if those guys improve or get better in 2021. If those guys come on quickly, then you know what? Maybe the Panthers find themselves an 8 or 9 win season. If those young guys don't improve, then the Panthers may finish closer to that 5 win mark that they had the year prior. So hopefully that does not happen for the Panthers fans out there. But if they get better, I think Carolina can be sneaky good and flirt with the playoffs for most of the year. So time will tell on that one. But with that said, here are my 3 expectations for the Carolina Panthers in 2021. Number 1, Sam Darnold has over 4,000 passing yards and 25 total touchdowns. So these are pretty modest expectations, but if he did this, I think Carolina Panthers fans would sign up for that right now. His career high in single season passing yards is 3,024, and he also had a career high 19 touchdowns in that same season back in 2019. And in that season, he did miss 3 games that year because, remember, he had mono, so he missed like the first month of the season basically. So anyway, here's my reasoning for that stat line behind Darnold. So number 1, Joe Brady, the offensive coordinator for Carolina, returns there, and he was very impressive last year in my opinion with Teddy Bridgewater as his quarterback. Brady has taken a lot of knowledge from his previous destinations like the New Orleans Saints and LSU, of course, and kind of implemented those into his own offense here in Carolina. There's a lot of spread formations, empty sets, vertical routes. They do a good job of attacking the one-on-one mismatches, and I think that will favor some of the things that Sam Darnold is good at. Number 2, the receivers and weapons he has now is better than any group he had with the Jets in 3 years. So give me DJ Moore, who's probably the best guy he's going to play with, Robbie Anderson, who he did play with the Jets, but now is a number 2 instead of a number 1, Christian McCaffrey, a top 3 running back in the league when he's healthy, Terrace Marshall Jr. out of LSU, who could be a very good player in his first year, and David Moore from Seattle, who was a nice player. I will take that group over anything the Jets gave him, like Chris Herndon and washed up Le'Veon Bell. I know they had Robbie Anderson, but Jamison Crowder, he's decent. Quincy Enunwa, Jermaine Curse, it just was not that great of a group there that the Jets gave him. And number 3, this offensive line that Carolina has is probably better than any offensive line the Jets gave Darnold for 3 years as well. So Cam Irving and Pat Elflein starting kind of concerns me, but the center, right guard, and right tackle spots are good in my opinion. Matt Paradis, you have John Miller, I believe, at right guard. Then you have Taylor Moten, who played amazing at right tackle last year. But even behind Irving and Elflein, they have guys like Brady Christensen, the rookie left tackle out of BYU. He was Zach Wilson's blindside protector there. And Greg Little was once a pretty high prospect. He was like a second round pick, I believe, out of Ole Miss a couple years back. So maybe he comes around finally. So basically, I think the Panthers are fine at center, right guard, and right tackle. The left side kind of concerns me, but they have guys on the bench that can fill in if things go poorly. But I will say, it's still better than any group the Jets gave him throughout his career. Number 2 for me is that they have a sneaky good defense. This is no longer the days of Luke Kuechly, Thomas Davis, Josh Norman, those guys. But I think this team has a lot of young talent, especially on defense. And while most people have little to no expectations for their defense, I would not write them off just yet. I want to see how this plays out first. I like some of the signings they made for their defense in the offseason. They brought in Denzel Perriman, a linebacker from the Chargers. He was coming off his best year, still pretty young. And they also brought in Hassan Reddick, who switched to edge last year for the first time, had a pretty productive year. He had 5 sacks against my Giants last year. And he once played under Matt Rhule and Phil Snow at Temple, so they do have some connections there. But they also have a bunch of young guys that are talented. Jeremy Chinn, he transitioned very well from a small school and played everywhere last year. Yetur Gross-Matos, the second round pick out of Penn State a couple years back. Brian Burns has been very good so far. Derek Brown at defensive tackle, who had a good year last year but can probably get even better in year 2. And of course, J.C. Horn, the cornerback they took this year out of South Carolina, one of my favorite cornerbacks in this class. It's a group with a ton of youth, a ton of talent, and a ton of potential. And if those guys all put it together, which is a lot to ask for, I get it, but if they do, that defense of Carolina can be somewhat good for them in 2021. And number three, second year safety. I don't even want to call him a safety. He plays everywhere. Jeremy Chinn has 140 plus combined tackles in 2021. So this one's pretty bold, but what we saw from him last year, I feel like it's possible in my opinion. And as a comparison, last year, the safety with the most tackles in the NFL in 2020 was Jordan Poyer of the Bills with 124. So 140 is not very easy to get. Now, the last player to get 140 plus was Buda Baker in 2019. I think he had 147. So it does happen. It's just not very likely. But Jeremy Chinn made that transition from Southern Illinois, which is a school that most of the guys he's playing against will not even come close to the NFL. So making that transition from there to the NFL, not even having a regular offseason, was very impressive in my opinion. This guy is 6'3", he's 220, he's built to last, and I think he'll be a special player one day. He definitely plays in the box and plays in the slot enough to keep him around the ball, so if a team runs the ball up the middle, Jeremy Chinn won't be there a lot of the times to take care of those tackles. He'll have to stay healthy, of course, and playing 17 games can help this number come to fruition. Last year, he played 15 games at 117 tackles, so if you kind of put those numbers together, bring up the 17 games, he's close. He's not exactly there, I feel like, if I'm doing the math correctly, but he's close, and I think a year or two improvement from him can get him to 140 plus in 2021. So that'll do it for this video. Hopefully you guys enjoy. Leave a like and subscribe if you did. I think next video we have the Cincinnati Bengals. I think the Bengals come before the Browns. I before L. I'm pretty sure that's correct. If not, then it's the Browns, but I'm pretty sure it's the Bengals. So hopefully you guys stay tuned for that one, and I'll talk to you guys next time.